two of the maps are there in fact, this is the zoning map. See all of the yellow colored area that is R-15 zoning in the city limits of Valdosta. What you see to the left in the green area, that is conservation zoning, that is unincorporated by Adams County. So the proposal is to move this R-15 portion that you see outlined out of the city limits into Adams County. But as noted in the staff report, there is still not yet a requested zoning district in the county. We talked about this at length at the work sessions. The annexations are somewhat unusual. The last time we had a de-annexation request was 10 years ago. So this is the first one. Some of you all were not up here 10 years ago, so we went through those rules. In many ways, it is like an annexation in reverse. However, in both cases of annexation or de-annexation, the final decision rests with Valdosta City Council. The only thing that's required of the applicant of the county to begin with is they must go to the county commissioners and get an adopted resolution of support, which basically consents to the de-annexation if the city should approve it. That was done earlier in the spring. The applicant required, this is a state law that requires that. They submitted that to us as part of their de-annexation request. Usually there is discussion of a county zoning district at that time. I'm not aware of any. Conservation zoning in the county would probably make the most sense. But the power to rezone land once it's in the county rests with the Adams County Commission. Valdosta has no jurisdiction there. The request in front of Valdosta is simply to de-annex or not. It's not a zoning decision. Simply an annexation. So we'll get more of that here in a few minutes. So the zoning map, you see a little bit how the city limits runs. The character area map, this is in parks, recreation, conservation, character area. And then one we don't see very often, that's the LG, which is linear green space and trails that runs along the Wilcoochee River stream channel. And that is coincides with what's called protected river corridor. Segment of the Wilcoochee, which is this part as it runs through Lowndes County south of Confluence, with Cat Creek, I think is where it starts. So that is one that barely touches the property, but most of it is in the PRC character area. But more interestingly, the aerial image you see is forest cover, a natural forest, a mixture of wetlands and uplands. But in this aerial, you see a little more readily the neighborhood pattern of Cherry Creek Hills, both North Lakeshore and South Lakeshore, as well as that of Cherry Creek North, which abut this property on its east. As a point of reference, you see the outline in bold yellow, the little tag at the bottom that sticks out. That is where this property has its only street frontage, at least on the open street, that is along South Lakeshore Drive. That is not a right-of-way or an easement. It's actually a 40-foot wide finger of property that is part of this parcel of land. So that's where this property attaches to the rest of the world in terms of street frontage. The only other area is along the Weir, Lake Lee, which was a public street running through there, but has been closed by the city government. Path is still there, but it's not open to vehicles. Of course, the residents of Cherry Creek are very familiar with that. Otherwise, it is private property, whether it be homes or the wooded areas, or in some cases with Cherry Creek North, it abuts the Property Owners Association common area for that neighborhood. In the packet, you see the survey of the overall Wetlands Mitigation Bank. This is the all 530 acres. You look at the north-south line, they sort of runs parallel and then through it. That's the city limit line. It's called the landlocked line. So part of the mitigation bank is in the city limits. Part of it is outside. The applicant is wanting to put all of it outside of the city limits. And the state and staff in the packet, the purpose is for wildlife management and recreational use. And I think the applicant will have to explain in further detail what exactly that means. Subject property, I think this is the gate that is down the path off of the South Lakeshore. And on the north side of the Weir where the road is closed, this is another access that is nearby. If you see the barrier across the roadway to the right, it's the mitigation bank signage that is there. It's hard to get good pictures of the property direction without walking down through it. And the mitigation bank sign. Some of the adjacent properties, Cherry Creek, this one I believe is to the south of the access from South Lake Shore, Lake Lee behind the weir. These are the houses as you go over it. There's a lot of information in your packet about the de-annexation process, some of the history of the property, which goes back more than 50 years ago when houses first started being built around the lake. Back then, a lot of it was in the county. After a few houses were built, the rest of the land was, I believe, given to the University of Georgia and annexed into the city. And the parts were developed, all the subdivisions, and the land came back into private ownership. About the year 2000, some work was going on with the Wetlands Mitigation Bank, and it was under local developers' control. My understanding is the mitigation credits of the bank were exhausted around the year 2007. The property went back to the Arches Foundation of EGA. Up until about 14, 15 months ago, when they came back to the applicant under private ownership. An annexation request, you know, we look at some, of course, the zoning change is a big factor of it. But the other thing to look at is the provision of city services. Annexation into a city is a discretionary approval, it's like de-annexation. Cities, even though property meets the requirements, cities are not obligated to approve an annexation. But one part of the analysis is how will city services affect the property itself, and how will the provision of those services affect the city's ability to provide services elsewhere. It's not just water and sewer, it's also fire and police protection, emergency services, and so forth. The annexation, the only issue really before the city is that same question, but in reverse. Taking part out of the city is not going to have a negative effect on the city services necessarily, but on a piece of property that has no access to anything but the city limits. If there were to be any development of any kind on this property, no matter how passive, unless you were able to cross the Lipahoochee River, only way to get to this property, even for something as simple as timber harvesting, would have to come through the city limits. If there was an emergency situation or fire and police were needed, the only access again is through the city limits. Makes it a little bit awkward if the property is not in the city, like it has been for many years. So I sum up all the information in the staff report with the question of why. The applicant stated reason. For de-annexation, I see it having a negative effect on the property, even if it is in a small degree, because there is no other way to get to this except through the city limits. So with all of that, and all the more detail that's there, staff is recommending you find the request inconsistent with the conference plan and to recommend denial of the de-annexation. Added on another request, that you also formally recommend that the applicant pursue voluntary annexation of the rest of the wetlands mitigation. I think it is logical to put it in one jurisdiction or the other, and since the majority of it is in the city limits, part that is not has the same considerations as what's in the city, it makes sense to staff to have all of the mitigation that is in the city limits. And that there's no requirement that we can force that upon the applicant. Glad to answer any questions you may have on that.
Matt, can you expand a little bit on the email that you sent us regarding
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I forgot this one. So much of over the weekend, I emailed you a packet of correspondence that we have received from the citizens. That's 11 pages worth. This evening, I handed you four additional items that we have received, mostly by email. Some of it you know is an email text, some of it is an attached letter. So those are distributed this evening. If we end up collecting any more this evening, then staff will add that to the city council packet. Correspondence you received over the weekend and this evening from me is already in the draft packet of the city council. So that part is already in motion. We tried to reply to all the emails and letters that we got, but people be assured that we have it, and it will be in the packets. I know there's a lot of people probably wanting to speak to you. You know, the minimum requirement under state law for time limit is 10 minutes per side. Just like we have done in other high attendance cases.
Right.
Perhaps a little more.
Okay, my question was about the code ordinance that you sent us. So if the purpose is for wildlife management and recreational use, is that possible under this code that you sent us?
Correct. It is possible as long as the request is made formally to the city, has to be approved by the city manager, the city attorney, and the city police chief.
And has that?
And that is for Hunt, that request has not been made that I'm aware of, and that was as of last week. The only requirement, as you see stated there, is that it has to be for hunting purposes and on a tract of land that is at least 150 acres, which this means. Only other area of the city limits I can think of that would qualify for this is the Brayland, parent parcels. That would be large enough to meet this as well. I had asked a question of city staff when this first came up, that when we discovered this in the code, is if approvals had already been granted in the past, either for this property or perhaps Brayland. Unfortunately, the manager and attorney and the police chief in those capacities have only been on duty for less than 5 years. I asked the city clerk, who has been there for 20 years, neither can think of any instance where it has been approved. My guess is decades ago, probably soon after this code change was approved, which is 1976, perhaps an approval was granted then. I know that is similar in date to when the bulk of this land was given for annexing to the city and then given to the UGA. And it predates the annexation of Brayland, which is in the late 1980s. So it is possible an approval was granted then, but the city clerk will have to do some digging. But nonetheless, this is open to the applicant now to make that formal request. There's no guarantee that it will be approved, but at least it can be asked. In terms of timber harvesting and other things, like they talked about the work session, R15 zoning allows some passive recreational type use. If it's more than that, then it's got to be rezoned to the city ER classification, which is similar to the county's conservation zone, except with a few more restrictions. And then harvesting can be allowed anywhere that's mandated under state law. You can provide access to these licensed harvesters. I know some questions came up with wildlife management and even timber management, and that's all held and controlled by fire departments and building forestry. It's completely separate processes from zoning.
The mitigation thing or conservation designation, is that a state level or a federal
designation? The wetlands mitigation bank is a federal designation approved by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. That went through about, I think, in 2001. And the more lies in a plaque, which is part of what you see in the packet. I think that is made in the spring of 2001.
That is not expired.
I don't know the rules and expirations of that. It may have. I don't know. Parts of me want to say someone has to be in perpetuity, at least for maintenance of it. But it, there may be a sunset. I'm not an expert on mitigation things.
Matt, I'm referring to this map here. It's very clear to me what portion of land the applicant is requesting to have. What I remain confused on is west of that parcel that he wants to annex. Where does his ownership, how much of the land west of what he wants to be annexed belongs to him, and who owns the rest of it?
Okay, if you look at the map on the screen, you see where you have sort of the background tract of land that straddles the city limits. And so north of there, there's an area of land between the river and the boundaries of the mitigation bank. That's owned by another entity. We talked about some of this in the work session.
Yes.
We were contacted about timber harvest and all that. Otherwise, what you're seeing is everything east of the river channel.
Okay, my other question is, I see where the run of the Withlacoochee River is. So the Withlacoochee River and the portion that he is not asking to be de-annexed is between, is east of, excuse me, west, east of, excuse me, west of the neighborhood.
Correct. He has a piece of land that's about 220 acres that's in the county, 310 acres in the city. Wants to move the 310 into the county.
Yes.
And the part that you see that's in the gap to the upper left, that's owned by the other entity, that is in the county.
So the one, going back to this map here, I'm assuming this R1 is the River Chase subdivision area, mostly?
River Chase and lands north of them. You see the stream pattern of River Chase?
Right.
So that and a lot of the vacant lands to the north, and then some of the hatched land, you might recall that being some of the DP zone neighborhoods from the past several years.
Okay. Thank you. I was just having trouble with my hands.
Thank you. Originally designated R15 because it was a mitigation area for the adjacent R15 or applied.
The R15 zoning came along upon its first annexation back in the 70s. All of Cherry Creek is in R15 and still is.
But this piece has no development value.
It has very, very limited. It is mostly consumed by wetlands and floodplain. There are some uplands areas. It is possible to do some development in floodplains, but you've got to follow an awful lot of rules about it. Generally makes it cost prohibitive. Also, there is very limited places for access to that area, at least for conventional development. I looked at the GIS system of these boundaries. There are a few small pocketed areas and potential maybe for a couple home sites. But getting to them will be a little bit of a challenge. Access is going to be a struggle, particularly with the road across the weir being closed. That cuts off a lot of the street frontage to this property.
Matt, just for clarification, that little figure at the stream bottom that we talked about last week, did I just hear you clarify that that is not evil, but is actually a lot?
Correct.
It's part of the property, right?
It is, if you use a good magnifying glass, yeah, and I zoomed in to see, you see it on the survey drawing. If you zoom in far enough, it is 40 feet wide, and it is part of this parcel of land. It is not an open right-of-way, it is not an easement across someone else's land. It is physically part of this parcel.
Okay, if not, let's open it up to the public. As Matt mentioned, there are a lot of people in here, and we probably will run over our time, which is okay. But let's keep in mind, if someone has already stated an issue or brought up an issue, if we don't repeat it, then that gives you time to talk about something else. So just keep that in mind. All right, is there anyone here tonight who wishes to speak on behalf of this request? Please come forward, state your name and address for the record.
Madam Chair, can I pass out some literature that may help shine some light on
you certainly
our restrictions with the on-board exchange program?
Sure.